Hey guys, welcome to lesson 3 of our course. So in this lesson, you don't have to model nothing. Just grab a beer or grab a coffee and just follow along. You can open the definition, which is included in the assets. So let's get started. So what is this definition? Don't get scared. It has a little bit of anemone in it, but it's quite simple. I'll walk you through it. So we start with a simple plane surface. That's it. And then we get an iso curve, which is basically just our starting curve, which in our case is the bottom curve. And we control it with this slider here. I can start also in the middle if I want to. But let's start on one side in the beginning. So what I then do is that I divide that curve with a fixed distance, 1 meter in this case. And those set of points, let's see, they're 21 points. So those 21 points, that's going to be the input for our anemone algorithm that starts looping. The loop is quite simple. Here the loop starts. This is the anemone component. I set it now to 0 loops. I'm going to walk you through the loops. But the first loop, what it does is that it creates spheres on the spots of those points, as you can see in the Rhino canvas. Then it intersects those spheres with the surface. So you get, well, these half circles, basically. The next step is to get the intersection between those circles, which are those. That's all the algorithm does. That's the technique Gehry Technology uses. And then the next step would be putting spheres on those positions again, getting the intersections, and then from those intersections, generating another set of points, getting spheres, etc., etc. This part here, this is basically just to make sure that we get the right intersections, because as we'll see in the next loop. So let me turn off, because I created some color swatches to make it a little bit more clear. So these are the circles and these are the intersection points. So let's go to the, let's reset it and let's go to the next round. So that will be 1. Nice. So as you can see here, if we just go to the intersections, you see that now we have 2 intersections. We have the new one, the one we actually want, and the old one. We don't want to go back to the old one again, because else the algorithm would loop between the new one and the old one, etc., and it wouldn't advance. So that's what this part does. It basically just checks like, hey, from the intersections we got, which one do we choose? And as a final fail-safe, I put remove duplicates, because as we will see in a while, if the surface gets more complex, if there's points that are closely together, they kind of multiply, and then in the next iteration, they multiply exponentially, and it will make your grasshopper definition crash, unfortunately. It's basically just a fail-safe, like, hey, if there are duplicates, remove them. And then here we go to the next round. And what this part of the definition just creates lines, like the triangles, basically, we get. Let's just loop the definition and see what it does. So let me set it to, I don't know, 15. Set it to 20 so it finishes. Nice. So these are all the points. And then the triangles generated by it. You see that we get a nicely triangular grid, and all the members, especially like these members, the diagonals basically, those are always going to be 1 meter. Let's do it again so you can see it. So you see them running like that. Now, obviously, on this surface, we could also just have used the Lunchbox component. Like, you might ask yourself, why are we doing it in this weird way? It's because as soon as your surface gets a little bit more complex, there's some weird stuff going to happen, because then the triangular grid gets stretched. Let me show you. Let me turn off this surface. And let's use a saddle roof surface. And this component is also from the Lunchbox plugin. So let's connect this one to the input surface, and let's see what's going to happen. gonna take some time. Let's give it a little bit more iterations. Let's say, I don't know, 30. Nice. So here you see that if a surface gets some convex and concave situations or bending, you see that there's some weird stuff going on. Because here, you know, the triangles get squeezed. So you see that here some points are going to get removed and then the triangulation gets messy, especially here. If I start in the middle, it's going to go to a concave shape and something else will happen. So let me switch it to zero. So let's start in the middle because now we start at one side. So this is the curve. Let's say we want to start somewhere here, like around 50. So it's in the middle. Let's set it to 30 and let's let it run. Now as you see, the opposite will happen. Instead of the triangles being stretched or squeezed, now they're getting stretched. And also the same thing happens that at some point, like it doesn't know properly how to make the triangulation. So let me go to top view and let me show it to you just with the plane surface. So let me set this one to zero. Like this. Let's start at the beginning. So this is our surface. But if I draw a line, just to make it more clear, instead of straight UV line, let's draw our own line. So just something like this. So let's reference that curve. And I invite you to play around with this definition so you get a better understanding of spherical packing. So let's start the definition. So this is a convex curve. Sorry, I think I messed up before. But this is like the bulge, it means convex, and the other one is concave. So let's run it with a convex shape. So let's set it to 20. And you see that in the beginning, the triangles are more or less the same size, but then you see that the horizontal, it gets stretched. But the diagonals, they're one. And that's the whole clue of the definition, to keep the hexagons more or less the same size. That's more or less the rule, that the diagonals are kept at the same dimension. And if I flip this one around, from convex to concave, you see that the opposite will happen, that instead of being stretched, they're gonna get squeezed. Nice. So in the beginning, they're all more or less the same size, but then here you see that they, you know, they get squeezed. And it's a very interesting method, but like we saw, when the surface gets more complex, is that the triangulation gets a little messed up. Of course, there's always ways to fix that. Also the edges, because now it converges to one point, so how would we take care of the edge conditions, which is also doable. But in the end, it's more easier and faster to use Kangaroo for this, because Kangaroo is perfect to do these kind of situations. We just apply the same rules that are used in this algorithm. It's basically just keeping two sides of the triangle the same length, and the third member, that's the one you play with. You stretch or squeeze depending on the surface curvature. And we can do the same with Kangaroo, I think even better. Because like I said, there's some issues using this method. So we're going to take a look at how to achieve that in the next lesson. Thank you for watching.